Hello, welcome. I've finally finished doing all the testing I'd like to do, and I'm back with a naval meta guide. Okay, so let's start with the lazy single player meta. The lazy single player meta is to use 1940 submarines because they don't cost a chromium, but you still want to research 1944 submarines because that allows you to put sub-engine 4s on, which makes you faster. And then you can put torpedo tubes on them. And then there are two levels of snorkels. One gives minus 10% visibility, the other one gives minus 20. There's an argument to be made to using radar. Radar will help you track down enemy fleets and convoys better, but that's up to you. Submarines are typically paired with naval bombers. Naval bombers are the best at sinking enemy ships, and air power in general is the best way to deal with an enemy fleet, especially if it's going to be larger than yours. Just put your naval bombers out at sea and naval strike them to death. I'm going to make a controversial recommendation. If you're going for submarines plus naval bombers, go base strike. If we look at the summary of the stats that are going to affect submarines and naval bombers, surface detection is not that big of a deal. Sub-org doesn't matter, actually. Your max org doesn't matter. It only matters if you drop below about 50%. If you're not being spotted, that doesn't matter. Sub-rating efficiency has to do with how many sea zones you can cover. So I come in here and I switch to convoy rating. If these were subs and I had that 50% bonus, it should be 45% rather than 30. Really, it's not that big of a deal. Torpedo reveal chance is how likely you're going to get revealed from firing torpedoes. It's base 3.5%. With this modifier, it's either 2.8% for trade interdiction or 2.9% for base strike. So realistically, that's not that big of a difference. Sub attack and HP benefit trade interdiction, which is nice, but subs don't really have a problem sinking most things. And then you have naval targeting. 20% bonus for trade interdiction, 40% for base strike, and you also get 50% bonus to your port strikes. The small difference between these two and this right here is the real reason I would recommend base strike over trade interdiction. Base strike is also the doctrine you want to go down if you're going to be an air controller in multiplayer. So with that out of the way, I would like to point out that most things work in single player. It is quite effective to make this light cruiser hull in single player. You have a ton of light attacks, so you're just going to go straight through everything. You have enough armor that most light piercing will take reduced damage against you, but heavy piercing will go right through you, but you're mostly fast enough that heavy attack is going to struggle to hit you. And overall, you just do a lot of damage. The AI cannot beat this. A player will go through this with ease. This is countered by the meta multiplayer build, and that is this. This is your main damage dealer. So you want to use the Coastal Defense Designer for the minus 25% production cost. Put as many light batteries as you can on it. The smallest of the three heavy batteries, because it reduces your speed the most, and the difference in heavy attack is not significant. So this is the basic design. So with carriers, you can use the Coastal Defense Designer to build basically the ship you want. And then you add on the AA last. And you want to add on the AA last because it has that 2.5% production cost modifier. When you refit, that only affects itself. It'll affect the hull cost and the new modules cost, but it won't have affected the cost of any of the other modules. And when you refit, you can use the Pacific Fleet Designer and get 100 deck size. And what this means is instead of spending 111,849 IC to build this from scratch, you can just spend 9,200. Do that four times, that's about two extra heavy cruisers you could have built instead of spending that time building carriers. Destroyer-wise, you've got Roach destroyers, of which there's two different design philosophies. There's the Complete Roach, which is just big engine, smallest gun, Coastal Designer, as cheap as possible. There's the other version where you add one torpedo to it so that it does something, and then you have the Fleet Destroyer. This is not necessary in a large number of fleets. Like if you're starting as the UK or Japan or the USA, your starting destroyers have so much torpedo attack, you don't really need this design. Just this design is good enough. It has a high enough speed that it is incredibly hard to hit, and it is quite cheap. You can make it cheaper, of course, but this ship literally only exists to die. It does nothing else other than screen. I would prefer this ship. So now let's move on to doctrine. So you have fleet and being trade interdiction, base strike. As I mentioned, if you're going to be using a lot of air power, base strike is the best. But that assumes you're not actually using a real fleet. If you're using a real fleet, it is debatable. Trade interdiction reduces your surface visibility, making it harder for the enemy to hit you. Fleet and being gives you 10% additional naval AA attack and capital ship attack. That cannot be understated. This makes you hit harder. This makes you harder to hit. And there is a balancing act between that. I'll show you some testing later where I do fleet and being versus trade interdiction. And a lot of the results are literally a coin flip. Run the battle 4 times and 2 times fleet and being will win, 2 times trade interdiction will win. Flexible contracts is very good if you want to do the refitting build, because it means instead of spending 150 for a naval designer, you'll spend 30 political power. Otherwise, naval reform, very good. Just increase that naval experience gain, and then naval refitting yards when you actually go to do the refitting. And then you can just stay on this during the war so that you repair your ships faster. In here, your best bet is instilled aggression. Attack is the best trait on admirals. It increases your damage. One of the reasons I don't use admirals later on is because if you start with a low level admiral, so they have the same skills, a lot of battles between equal ships will be determined entirely by how the admirals level up. If one admiral gets a ton of level ups into attack and the other one gets it more evenly spread out, the side that got all the attack tends to win, unless you're trying to get these specific traits. If you're trying to get bold, you don't want to use these two. These ones prevent you from getting any personality traits, so you can't get bold on your admin. Bold is the best trait you can have on an admiral. Within here, the best bet you can get is knight fighting. I honestly thought decisive battle would outperform knight fighting, but it doesn't. If you know your fleet is going to be substantially bigger, positioning might actually be better to counter the bigger fleet penalty. But otherwise, if your fleet's approximately the same size, knight fighting is better than decisive battle. When it comes to your chief of navy, your best bet is naval speed. As much as that attack and armor and attack and defense looks good, naval speed is still better. Naval speed and night visibility versus decisive battle and decisive battle, naval speed wins. Even though stacking decisive battle should give you 10% extra damage and 10% extra hit chance, it doesn't overcome the visibility and the speed bonus, especially the speed bonus on destroyers. Adding that 10% speed to destroyers makes them nearly impossible to hit versus destroyers that don't have it. Be wary of any of these plus agility targeting attacks modifiers. There have been people who've done testing and they say that these modifiers do not actually do anything. Sortie efficiency does work though. Admiral traits, concealment expert is one of the best you can get. That minus 20% visibility is huge. Cruiser captain is very good, although it is very hard to get fly swatter because that requires you to fight enemy air units, which is, it's just very hard to get this unless you start with an admiral that already has it. Fleet protector is also quite nice. The additional screening efficiency means you'll maintain 100% screening efficiency even as you lose ships. Torpedo screen penetration is largely worthless. It does not let you bypass screening efficiency. It only allows you to penetrate screening efficiency 25% more. So when you're going for a submarine captain, Silent Hunter. Down here, torpedo bomber and dive bomber might be entirely useless. The 10% air attack bonus is not important at all, and at best you're getting 2 additional naval attack on your naval bombers, assuming the air mission efficiency actually works. It does not improve your sortie efficiency. That extra 2 naval attack will get multiplied by 5 for carrier combat. You might see a small increase in the amount of damage naval bombers do. That is assuming it works, and there are actually a good number of air-related modifiers that don't do anything. The sortie efficiency is nice. Capital ship armor, not very important. Safety first. Destroyer leader is also really nice if you can get it, but concealment expert is number 1. Don't go for smokescreen specialist on your main navy guy. This is not worth anything. You don't want your navy to retreat. When your navy retreats from battle, all it does is attack the closest target to it. Your navy basically turns stupid when you retreat, so just don't use this. And like I mentioned earlier, bold. 10% speed, 5% damage, most important thing you can get on an admiral. Let's move on to some testing. I'm going to do some testing of fleet and being versus trade interdiction using the same designs. We're going to use this as our roach design. Then we have the fleet destroyer, which has max torpedoes, a 1940 heavy cruiser with as much light attack as possible. There are those who'd argue to remove the AA, makes it slightly cheaper, slightly faster. I think if you know you're going to go up against carriers, then you should keep the AA. And then we have 2 designs, the carrier. So we have this design using the coastal defense, which is really cheap. And then this design, which adds the AA and switches it to the Pacific fleet designer, which gives it 100 deck size. And these designs are the same for the other side for this first battle. Naval speed guy and night fighting. We're fighting in the Gulf of Mexico because it's an ocean, and it's one of the only oceans that both the US and the UK can reach at the same time. We are not going to be using admirals. It makes testing unpredictable because they'll get level ups. We are going to use a 45-55 split. I prefer slightly more naval bombers than fighters. Always engage. Don't repair. Don't split off. Now the battle will commence. It's raining. That benefits trade interdiction. I'm going to record the results, but I am going to note that it was raining. Okay, test run two. Let's hope it doesn't rain this time. And it started raining halfway through the battle. But it did not end up mattering. The ships that are designed to die don't actually die very well. They're actually much better at speed tanking than actually dying. Okay, test 1-3 is clear to start the battle. That was quite interesting. The British ran out of destroyers first, but the Americans still lost because their heavy cruisers had taken such damage. Alrighty, go for test 4. That is extremely poor luck for the Americans to start the battle off. The problem the Americans are having is they're just taking so much damage from the heavy cruisers' guns. So again, that was the same result. Must be discarded. We'll wait a couple days before starting this next one. Okay, test run 4. It's in a storm this time. Benefiting the Americans to start, though. Okay, the Americans won even through a storm. So I'd like to point out the British have been losing more of their planes each time. That is the plus 10% naval AA from fleet and being. Okay, test 5. The British should be the ones to engage this time. Okay, we got a storm in the middle again. Okay, the Americans have lost a cruiser, which means it should die. Yep. Okay, let's go for test 6. So far, it's been a coin flip. Okay, we started this battle in the rain. Last rainy battle went towards trade interdiction. Okay, it is quite literally a coin flip. So this is the end result after 6 battles. It is literally a coin flip. However, on average, when trade interdiction wins, they are preserving more of their capital ships, which would suggest you should go towards trade interdiction. So we've gone over the meta fleet, but if that's the meta, there has to be a way of challenging that. On the US side, we have what is supposed to be the counter to light attack heavy cruisers with roach destroyers. In this version, we're going with a complete roach destroyer design. Our heavy cruisers are supposed to deal with the enemy cruisers, so in this version, we don't need anything other than a meat shield. For the heavy cruisers, we have as many heavy cruiser batteries as you can fit. And this is giving us a lot of HP. We're using the coastal defense designer, even though it gives the minus 20% heavy attack. And we're going to go with our 90 heavy attack. That's quite a bit, because if we compare it to the heavy cruiser with light attack, it only has 200 HP. So three hits, and you should be able to sink it. So this is supposed to be the counter. Let's see how they do. We have the US fleet heading down there, and the British fleet is already here. So let's go over the numbers in each fleet. We have 4 carriers on both sides. Going past that is not cost effective. You can go to 5 if you need to, but if you're trying to use naval bombers from your carriers, going past 5 effectively reduces the number of carriers you have. To overcome the overstacking penalty, you need 20 carriers just to break even with 4. Once you get to 25 carriers, then you will effectively have 5 carriers in the battle. That's just the way the penalty works. We've got 22 heavy cruisers with heavy attack here versus 28 heavy cruisers with light attack, and then 132 screens because they need 128 for that 4-to-1 ratio. You definitely want to maintain the 4-to-1 ratio. And then over here, this is quite a bit more than the 4-to-1 ratio, but this fleet is designed based on the idea that you know you're going up against light attack heavy cruisers. So when you do that, you're going to want to bring as many extra destroyers as you can so that they stay alive while you're busy killing their capitals. Both fleets have night fighting and naval speed guy. Alrighty, so let's see how these two fleets fight it out. So the British start out thinking they are heavily outnumbered. Both fleets are in do not retreat. And as we watch the battle go on, you'll notice these guys are taking a lot of damage from heavy guns. And we're going to start sinking their heavy cruisers or forcing them to retreat. And when you start taking damage and you start dropping below 50% health, you start losing a ton of orc. When your orc is that low, your attack values plummet through the floor. So we're starting to run out of screens at this point, which is ruining our naval hit chance. But they're running out of capitals. So now that they have nothing in here, our heavy guns are going to start hitting their capitals. And it is basically at this point you want to retreat. We could have stuck around a little bit longer, maybe done a little bit better, but we still have all of our capital ships, as damaged as they are, and they've lost all of theirs. But you'll notice we ran into one problem. We couldn't deal with their screens. And over time, as we lost our screens, their screens started dealing damage to us. So we need a little bit more light attack. So I do have an alternative save set up. On the British side, we're going to have 27 heavy cruisers with light attack, 4 carriers, and 27 destroyers. On the American side, we're going to have 18 heavy cruisers with heavy attack, 5 heavy cruisers with light attack, and another 136 destroyers. So one problem you're going to have with this fleet is you cannot detect the enemy, but there's ways around that. Convoy raiding can force the enemy's hand, force them to take part in a battle they don't want to, and the added convoys ruin their screening efficiency, so there's ways around this. But the British found us, and that's all that matters. So we have 1987 heavy attack versus their 440. They have 1693 light attack to our 492. We have no torpedoes. They ran out of heavy cruisers, well, other than the 4 that retreated. They're now running out of carriers, and now let's see, can we actually deal with their destroyers? So we did manage to deal with their destroyers. We lost 2 heavy cruisers just to their destroyers after we'd taken out their capitals, so we could have retreated at that point. But as you can see, we are quite clearly winning this battle. So now the question is, what's the right balance of that? Some sort of 1-to-4 ratio of light attack heavy cruisers to heavy attack heavy cruisers works well dealing with their destroyers and with their capitals. Now the alternative is you just take out their capitals and then run, and you don't bring any light attack heavy cruisers. That is a little more risky though, because that means you're not sinking nearly as much IC. We are spending nearly equal IC on destroyers as we are on the heavy cruisers. Anyways, that is the naval meta, light attack heavy cruisers, and how to beat the naval meta, heavy attack heavy cruisers. The way that is supposed to defeat heavy attack heavy cruisers is light cruisers with light attack. However, they get beaten by heavy attack light cruisers, it's kind of a triangle. So if you're bringing a mixture of heavy attack heavy cruisers and light attack heavy cruisers, you're going to be prepared for whatever the enemy throws at you. However, the best default is light attack heavy cruisers, because taking out their screens and then destroying their capitals with your own screens is the most consistent method of dealing with the enemy. Light cruisers with light attack also suffer from one other problem. They don't get the 40% naval hit chance modifier from 100% screening efficiency. So that is the other problem.